that heaven's gate opened up the gate, and the children danced, and they saw your face, as happy as they were to see you come in. I was just as sad to have to watch you go.
Each one for coming today as we celebrate the homegoing of Sister Sybil. And we just speak peace and blessing over each one. And just want to celebrate a homegoing. And as the song said, why would we pray for her to be here with us whenever our goal is to make it home to be with the Lord? That's what our goal is. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we begin our service. Heavenly Father, we just thank you today for your love, your mercy, and your grace. And we thank you for each one that's gathered here. We just speak peace and blessing over each one. We pray your blessings over the friends and the loved ones that have gathered here to celebrate the homegoing of Sister Sybil. And Lord, we just pray that you'd minister grace unto each one as they go through the following weeks and the months and the years ahead. And Lord, let them have fond memories, thinking back over their lifetime with Sister Sybil. So, Lord, we just pray your blessings over each one now. Pray your blessings over this service. And we say, let your will be accomplished in every heart and life, and something be said or done that can touch somebody for the glory of God, that we'll have hope of seeing her again one day. Let it all be done for Christ's sake. For his name's sake, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
down in the valley, don't you stay, for you're never
Springs grew up during the Depression. Her father was a sharecropper, and she helped in the fields with her family. I feel that this is probably what led to her love for growing vegetables and flowers and working outdoors. Most of the memories that I treasure are the ones of me sitting on the stool beside Grandma, picking beans in her garden. I spent most of my summers helping with everything from harvesting to canning and storing the vegetables we gathered. There were lots of conversations that took place during those long, hot summer days, and one spent in the kitchen helping her with cooking that helped shape me and mold me into the person that I am today. Although she loved the outdoors, in 1978, she began helping Granddaddy run an old country store. She found herself growing bored being inside and decided to start writing about childhood memories at first. Then, at the request of friends and family, she continued to write on many different topics. Some of her writings were inspirations from Bible verses and God. She wrote in hopes that her poems would be a blessing to others who read them. In 2009, she was so excited about her published book of poems, Inspired Memories. She presented copies of her book to her family and friends. She dedicated her book to her children and grandchildren. Although my favorite poem is the one that she wrote about me, I will be sharing the poem that she wrote about my sister, Doreen. You see, I was my grandma's first grandchild, and although I know I was special to her, Doreen was an extra special gift from God. Doreen was born when I was 3 years old, and coincidentally, God saw it fit to bring her back home to him when she was only three. Doreen was unable to walk and talk. However, she brought so much joy to our family with her smile and the one word that she had learned to speak. When you would walk into the room where she was, She would look up at you and smile, wave her hand, and say, "Hey!" There was a lady who attended Stone Chapel Church back then who sang a song called "Angel Unaware." Those words stuck with Grandma, and she would always say that Doreen was her angel unaware. I guess this is what inspired her to write Doreen's poem, "Dearest Doreen." "Little angel unaware, sent to us from God above, was a blessing to our hearts when she laughed and tried to talk. I can see her upturned face shining bright with happiness as she looked at us to say, 'Hey.' Holding her was our good pleasure, but the love she gave us we cannot measure. So within our hearts we'll always keep a token of her memory. Now looking up, we visualize a little girl in paradise, waiting for the perfect time when she'll be ours to hold again." As I've read through Grandmama's book several times since her passing, it has brought back so many memories of her reading and sharing her poems. It has also reminded me of how much God and family were always the hub of her thoughts. There is no doubt in my mind that she prayed for all of us daily. I'm convinced that her prayers reached heaven on my behalf, and this is one of the reasons that I'm as blessed as I am today. She had such a sweet soul, and now her soul has been reunited with her Creator. She's no longer suffering or in pain, but she's praising the Lord, walking through the streets of gold. She's been reunited with all of her family and friends that have gone on before her. In closing, I would like to share another poem that she wrote entitled "My Children." Even though it is written to her children, I'm sure she would say, "Share with all my family and friends. I want to be reunited with them one day." My children, why can't you see? I'm getting so worried about where you'll be whenever I go to eternity. Jesus is waiting. He wants you to come. He wants you to be with your loved ones. But how can you go, oh, how can you go, if you don't hear or see or know the love of God while here below? My children, why can't you see? I want you to come and be close to me whenever I go to eternity.
Like Lisa, I remember his poems. I always thought that was the best one. So. But she did like to write those poems and things that she did that made her so special in so many ways. On behalf of the family, I do want to thank everybody for coming here today. But I especially want to thank those who were such an integral part in the care of Grandma through these last few years when things have been so rough. To Ruth, Shirlene, Janet, Kathy, Faye, Helen, Edith, and Stacy, each of you are very special to Grandma and to our family. We greatly appreciate everything you did. To Aunt Jerry, we're all aware of the sacrifices that you made over the past few years to make sure that Grandma got the proper care she needed. That meant so much to us, and I know it meant a lot to Grandma. Andrea, you really stepped up. I know you really helped fill in those gaps that Sherry had when she couldn't help, and you've made a lot of difference. And really, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart, everything that you did to help Sherry help Grandma. What I want to talk to you today is a little bit about things that we learned at Grandma's house. You see, as the grandchildren, there was no place we'd rather be than Grandma's house. All the time, whether it was weekend or summer, that's where we wanted to go. Each of us have fond memories of those weekends and summers we spent there. And while I'm sure we probably didn't spend every single weekend there, it sure seemed like we did. It seemed like we were always there. But these are all my fondest memories I have as growing up as a child, is spending those times with Grandma. But when I started thinking about the things that we learned at Grandma's, there was one thing that I think we all knew. And that was rule number one. Brent was the favorite. Don't ever doubt. If you got any question, you know Brent was number one. She loved all of us, but I just don't think we all quite got to where Brent was. I don't know what he did. But he achieved something somewhere along the way that we all strove to try to get to.
We always tried to pick with Big Daddy. We confronted Grandma about this several times. But Grandma, being the Christian she was, I truly believe Grandma never told a lie. We'd say, "Grandma, we knew Brent's the favorite." She'd just say, "Oh, hush." She never denied it. And she never admitted to it either, but we all knew. But another thing we learned at Grandma's was the value of hard work. Because we didn't just go to Grandma's to have a good time. When we were there, we worked. We did chores. We did a lot of things. We raked yards. We hauled wood out of the woods. Granddaddy would go cut the wood down. Sometimes Daddy would go do it. I remember Daddy cutting his leg in the woods with us one day and sewing it up in Grandma's bathtub. Things like that I don't think I'll ever forget. But we brought that wood back, and I remember me and Travis and Ron would stand out on the side of the yard, and we'd be out there after dark splitting wood with the axe. And it kind of became a competition to who could split the biggest piece of wood. And even after Granddaddy went and bought that hydraulic wood splitter, we still like to use the axe. It was just a bonding time that we as grandchildren had, and we really enjoyed that. We always helped Grandma rake the yards. I'm pretty sure Grandma had 122 pine trees in that yard. There was always pine straw had to be raked up. We worked to help keep the flower beds clean because she really loved those flowers. She spent a lot of time those, not as much as she spent in the garden. We spent a lot of time out there in the garden with her, just like Lisa said earlier. She would always tell us when we stayed with her in the summertime, she'd come wake us up first thing in the morning. "We got to get out here before it gets hot. We got to get out there." And so we did. And the thing we did every day when we came back in, whatever we were picking that day, we got back in, she always made sure we were back in time to watch The Price is Right. As we were selling those beans, sitting on the couch there. And so I really enjoyed those days. One thing that Travis mentioned earlier, is she said, I remember we were going to Florida, to Lake City with her one day, and we noticed there was a sign for a bean shell coming into town. And then Travis asked her, he said, "Grandma, why we sell these beans all the time when they got people to do it?" And she said, "Ain't nothing like free labor, Travis." Another thing that Grandma did, I'll never forget, is her Saturday tradition of buying groceries. You know, living where Grandma lived, this is not, nowadays I feel like I go to the grocery store every day. But where Grandma lived, that was a Saturday morning deal. On Saturday, she went and bought groceries. Sometimes we got to go with her. But when we didn't go, we stayed at the house and waited for her to come back home. We were also anxious to help put up those groceries and see what treats that she had brought us. There were times she brought, sometimes it may be a Nutty Buddy or some Nilla Wafer cookers, you never knew what kind of candy she was going to bring back. There was always something. But she always had something special for whoever was staying with her that weekend. Washing dishes, something just as simple as that. Grandma asked us to wash dishes. We didn't complain. We went and washed the dishes because Grandma wanted us to do it. So we learned to do that. Even to going out and hanging clothes and picking them off the clothesline in the backyard. We did those things. And, you know, in times like that, you don't realize the blessings that you're getting. It felt like we were doing chores, but we were really getting to spend time with Grandma. So we were very lucky for that. And probably one of the funnest things I always felt like was when we had to go outside and turn the TV antenna. All y'all remember those days. Somebody would walk outside and start to turn it, and she'd say, "Whoa, back up." Yeah, turn it back a little further back the other way. So we did all that. But one thing while I do know these were all chores that we were doing while we were there, I really and truly, I don't remember any of us ever complaining because we were just so happy to be there with Grandma. Another thing we learned from Grandma is we learned respect. We learned to say sir and ma'am, Mr. and Mrs., aunt and uncle. You respected your elders and you addressed them with their proper titles. We learned good manners and we learned how to treat everybody the same. Didn't matter if they were rich or poor. Even if they were poorer than us, it wasn't many. They were a few. But everybody got treated the same. But the thing is she never had to push this on us. She never had to say, "This is how you're going to act." That's the life that she lived. So we just followed in her footsteps and we took up the cues that she dealt us. We picked up and we took those along the rest of our lives. Probably the biggest thing I think you'll notice is we all learned how to eat. You can look around as you look at the family and some of us pallbearers here, some of us paid a lot of attention when she was teaching. The Sunday dinners were the best. It almost always had fried chicken, potato salad, rice and gravy, macaroni and cheese, some of those biscuits, and we all remember the biscuits. And there was always some kind of fresh vegetable from the garden that she and Granddaddy grew. At the end of every meal, she always had something sweet to eat. There was always some kind of cake. There was always a cake on the table at Grandma's house. Whether it was a pound cake or one of the red velvet cakes, there was always something there sweet to eat. But the other thing that I can always remember, she always had a box of ice cream in the fridge. You'd always go down the hall, back into Mickey's room, and she had ice cream back there. You'd pick out whatever flavor you wanted. It was like going to the ice cream store there. But there was a time back in the late 90s and early 2000s where I think a lot of grandchildren, we started to grow up. We were in the high school, the college, the young adult age. And we got to a point where we were eating dinner with Grandma almost every Sunday. And those are the days I think I'll cherish the most, because we were old enough to realize the blessing that we were having when we were eating lunch with her on those days. And I think I'll always cherish those days the most. But as good as Sunday dinner was, she really pulled it all out for the holidays. Whether it was Christmas, Thanksgiving, whatever, she always spent days, it seemed like, cooking. And we had all the food in the world. We'd always eat those. But one thing never changed, even on Mother's Day. It didn't matter what meal we were doing, if it was a Sunday dinner, if it was Mother's Day meal. Grandma was never going to be the first one to eat. We could sit her down at the table, put the food in front of her, hold her down, and she wasn't going to do anything until she got up last. And she wanted to be the last one at the table. She had to make sure that everybody had what they wanted and didn't eat anything else, because that was just her nature. She always wanted to make sure that everyone had what they needed, and she always put everyone else ahead of herself. Another thing that we learned from Grandma is that church is not optional. Grandma loved his church, and she loved God. Anytime we called her to ask if we could spend a night with her, she never told us no. And even on those times when I think Granddaddy didn't want us to come, she'd say, call back and ask Granddaddy. And we'd call back, and Granddaddy would say, well, yeah, come on. But she'd always say, don't forget those church clothes. You don't bring church clothes, you're not coming to my house. Because she wanted to make sure that we were here in Sunday school, we were here for children's church. And when we were here during the week, we came on Wednesday night service too. But she always brought us along with her. Another thing we learned at Grandma's house was the joys of singing. She always sung everywhere she went. She was cleaning the house, cooking, working in the yard, it didn't matter. She always had a hymn on her tongue and she was singing. Seems like a lot of us in the family picked up that love for music. None of us have a lot of talent, but we all like to sing. Another thing we learned from Grandma is we learned how to love. It didn't matter if it was family, friends, strangers, or God. She loved everyone, and because of that, everyone loved her. She is the one person that I can honestly say, I've never heard anybody say a bad word about my grandma. She was greatly loved by everyone, including us. Anyone who met her, they knew her love, they knew her Christian spirit was a part of her daily life. I never saw her get mad, never saw her hold a grudge. She always had a little joke about she always voted opposite of Granddaddy. I don't think I'll ever forget that. She said, I think she did it just to get on him. She said if she found out he voted for Reagan, she was voting for Doug. Yeah. She said she always voted for somebody different just to kind of show him up. But she always had a smile on her face, and she was always glad to see us when we came over. Probably the biggest thing I do remember about Grandma, and Lisa mentioned this a minute ago, is I remember her nightly prayers before she went to bed. Because when we stayed with Grandma, a lot of times we stayed in that bedroom across the hall from hers. And as you could stay in that room there, you could hear it, even with the door closed. And you could hear word for word of what she was saying. And I'd always remember her praying for different people in the family. It didn't matter if they were having personal issues, they were trying to find a job, if they were sick, or if they weren't coming to church. She was praying for them. And I remember hearing that over and over again. I don't think I'll ever forget that. So to everyone who has called us, who's texted us, who sent flowers, sent memorials, stopped by to see us, I want all of you to know how much we appreciate it. It's helped us immensely to see just how many people cared about Grandma and her family. We're all sad about the loss of our grandma. Without a doubt, she's going to be greatly missed. She made us all better people, and that's what really set in. Thankfully, we got a lot of great memories of our times together with Grandma, and I know we're all going to cherish them forever. I know we're not going to forget Grandma. While Grandma's passing has been a great loss to our family, it gives us comfort to know that we did not lose her, because we didn't. She's not lost. We know right where she's at. Grandma's not here in this box. That's not her. She's walking the streets of gold right now. She's probably singing a song. She's probably cooking a nice dinner today for everybody that was around. We know she's probably walking. She's talking to Granddaddy and to Johnny and to Stephen. She's talking to Sheila, Roger, and Mickey. Without a doubt, she's having a talk with Ryan and Doreen. She's all talking to him, all of them. We know she's doing these things. We know she's probably got a garden and she's got her house clean as it can be. But one thing I can tell you, there's not a doubt in my mind, while she's there, she's bragging on Brent.
Y'all might find that I repeat myself a little bit because of what Jason said and Lisa said, but there's something to just stuck with all of us. Some of my fondest memories of my childhood were with our grandma. Grandma would be so tickled when any of us came over. First, she would fuss at us for not coming sooner, then tell us the house was a mess, even though it was spotless, and then she would make sure we were fed. Her home greeted us with the smells of the wood-burning stove and biscuits in the oven. Her yard was always well-kept with colorful flowers and big rose bushes. Sometimes she would be out in the garden picking beans with her big brim hat on. Brent, Andrea, and I are from a slightly younger generation than our older grandchildren relatives, and we had a little bit better experience sometimes. We would fight over who got to sleep with Grandma, and usually nobody won, we just all slept with her. We would say our prayers and stay up talking with Grandma about God and heaven, and we'd sing and praise God for the blessings of that day. I will always remember her sweet voice. She was always singing, whether it was a hymn or a fun song she made up. She would sing about the birds outside and how we're cleaning the dishes and how we're mopping the floors. And we sing and clean and cook. And Grandma made us dresses and taught us all how to cook and take care of ourselves. She made sure we acted right and had manners and helped without being asked to do it. Sorry. She never asked for anything. She didn't need what she called worldly things. A few years ago, I got the luxury of interviewing Grandma, and I asked her how her grandchildren made her proud, and she said, when they do good and make good and have good jobs and can take care of their families. And when I asked her what have been some of her happiest and proudest memories in her life. So sorry. She said, having the family around, especially when I cook for them on Sunday dinners, and I have enjoyed my grandchildren. And her highest hopes for us were that we all go to heaven. And today and every day hereafter, I want us all to remember how strong and amazing Sybil was. Help. Going to Grandma's always felt like home. That's it. I started crying.
Oh,
Sister Sybil sing today, did you? And playing in the background was Sheila playing her trumpet. But I want to thank Sherry and who all was involved in giving us this invitation to come. It's been 30 years, and we have been back a couple of times when Brandon was pastor. And he shared something the last time I was here with doing a homecoming. And when he was a small boy, went by his house to pray for his mom. And we got ready to pray, and I said, son, cut the TV off. Or his mom said, cut the TV off. And he said he was right at the end of a cartoon, and he said, Brother Jimmy, I hated to turn the TV off. And he said, but people still don't want to turn it off today. So we see there's a lot of things that don't change, but with what our brother was talking about, there are a lot of things that have changed. And not very many people's outside turning a TV antenna today. Amen. We watching TV on our phone. But we appreciate the opportunity to come and speak a word for you and share some things. I believe we got a word from the Lord, and we'll share that with us. But I want to say that we appreciate Carolina Funeral Home for taking care of Miss Sybil and the hospice, working with her during these last several months. But let's just go in where we need to go. Psalm 16:11. It says, you will show me the path of life, and in your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. And I called it the three P's, the path, the presence, and the pleasures. And we work with youth, and I thought about Brother Terry Tripp and Sister Lois. They pastored here. And Brother Terry and Sister Lois kind of started this talent stuff with the King's Kids that Sheila was involved in, and the talent program for our Pentecostal Holiness children. And Tammy and I, we've worked with young people over the years in the talent program, and all three of our children participated, and they all went to the national level there. So we're thankful for the talent program that helps our young people develop some talents. But I taught our children as we worked with them and the different children in the churches where we pastored, we got to practice the three P's. We give them three P's, and that wasn't necessarily path, presence, and pleasure, but it was pray, practice, perform. Pray, practice, perform. And we did it in that order. And these children bring home the gold. And they had medallions and trophies and plaques and certificates. Sister Sybil has crossed the finish line. Hallelujah. She's won the gold. She's made it home. She's won the crown of life. Jesus said, if we'll be faithful unto death, I'll give you a crown of life. So we can put that wherever we want to put it, whether we want to be faithful or don't be faithful. But if you will be faithful unto death to the Lord, he's got a crown of life waiting for you. He said this verse not only helps us to enjoy life now, but also to help us to enjoy life forever. These words explain the verse. And these are the three P's that I mentioned, path, presence, and pleasure. He said, you will show me the path of life. And a path is a trail or a route or a route or a well-trodden road or a highway. Highway U.S. Route 20 is the longest road in the U.S. It starts in Boston and goes through Newport, Oregon, over 3,000 miles. And then I-90 is the longest interstate highway. And it goes from Boston to Seattle, Washington, and it's over 3,000 miles. And I-40, we're more familiar with that. It runs from Wilmington, North Carolina, to Barstow, California, about a little over 2,500 miles. And Tam and I, we run that going back and forth Oklahoma City. But almost everyone wants to go to heaven. Almost everyone. And because I guess there are some people who neglect this, they ignore this, I just don't care about where they're going to spend eternity. And we hope that's not the case with anybody here today. For most folks, I think we all want to go to heaven and spend eternity with the Lord, spend eternity with our friends, and spend eternity with our family. there's a hindrance on that road to where God is. There's a hindrance on that road to where Sister Sybil is. And that hindrance is a roadblock, if you please. And that hindrance is called sin, S-I-N. Nobody wants to talk about sin any longer, and that's okay, but that's still the problem. That's still the issue. They want to talk about this problem. They want to talk about those people. They want to talk about these issues. But sin's still the problem, and there's only one way to take care of that. And we see that we don't have to be mean people. We don't have to be murderers or thieves to have to deal with that sin issue. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We inherited this from Adam and Eve. Just like some of you guys inherited your hair color, your skin color, your eye color, and the different features that we inherit from our family, we inherited this from Adam and Eve. Wasn't anything we did. We just happened to be born in the human race. And if we're born in, then we're born into sin. And he said the wages of sin is death. And Romans 5:12 says, by one man this sin entered the world, and this brought a roadblock. That's kind of vanilla, a way for cookers. he was trying to get that worked out. But anyhow, because of that roadblock on the highway of life, people began looking for an alternate route, some way to get around that roadblock, and a way to get back into the presence of God. Some people think, because of that, that there are many ways that we can get to heaven, and just like there are many roads that we can go from South Carolina to California. But there's only one road. There's only one road. And Jesus said that road would take us to glory. That road would take us to heaven, to the place where God is, to the place where Sister Sybil is. There's only one road. And Jesus said, I'm that road. I'm the way. I'm the truth. I'm the life. Nobody is going to the Father except by me. So we can try to work it this way, and we can try to do this, that, or the other. There's only one way to get to where our sister's at today. And from the testimony we've already heard from the grandchildren, look here, she laid it right out for us that we could see. If you wanna go to where I'm going, you can follow in my footsteps. I'm on the right road, and I'm going to glory. Matthew 7 says, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide, and the way is broad that leads to destruction, and there are many who are on that road. For the gate is small, and the way is narrow that leads to life, and there are few who find that. Jesus is the very presence. He's the very person of God that was manifest in the earth. Jesus, the sinless Son of God, died for our sins, and he did that. He did what we couldn't do for ourselves. He took the blockade down, and he opened up the road for us. He was made, Paul said in the 2 Corinthians, that he was made sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So while many people are searching for an alternate route to get around the blockade, Jesus came into the world and he said, I'll take care of this. And he did. He gave us power to overcome that obstacle. Sister Sybil found that secret. She found the secret how to get on that road and stay on that road. She found the pathway to heaven. When she received Christ as her Savior, the Lord gave her the power and the authority to break through that blockade, to break through that roadblock, and to stay on the road going to heaven. And we're thankful that we were able to do those same things. When we receive Jesus as Lord and Savior for our life, he puts us on the right road that's going to heaven. It puts us in a right relationship with our Heavenly Father, and in his presence, there's fullness of joy. As we trust God and we go forward in life, we encounter treasures and pleasures that he has for us, and there are things that he wants us to enjoy in life, and there are treasures and things that he wants us to enjoy as we travel this journey. But he wants this life to be a life of joy for those who trust him. Though Sister Sybil had health issues that she had to deal with over the past several years, there was a time when she could do the things that really brought her joy. And what she was doing in these last few months, the last few years, was this music that you're listening to, that was her joy. And they had devotional times, and they had this worship time with these songs. These are some of her favorite songs. But we know that she loved her family. We know she loves her friends. We know she loved her church family. And as I mentioned, we were able to pastor here several years ago, and Sister Sybil was faithful. She was faithful, faithful Sunday school teacher. She's a member of the church, and for over 50 years, she taught a Sunday school class with the children, and she also enjoyed singing specials in church, writing poems for various occasions. She was a homemaker. For many years, she used her sewing skills to make her own clothing. She had a great love for gardening and canning and growing beautiful flowers, and was an excellent cook. And one of her greatest joys in life was spending time with the grandchildren. That was one of her greatest joys. As her health declined, she and Sherry had church at home. They had their devotional time at night. So as you go through life, dealing with all of these physical issues that may be beyond our control, and we'll have to deal with things. Just as sure as we're standing here today, and she's lying in state today, this coming day, breath is going to leave our body. And we're going to be ushered into the presence of God and give account of our stewardship in this life. But as we're dealing with these things and things that may be beyond our control, if you're able to do the things that you enjoy, things that bring fulfillment and gratification, you need to enjoy those things, because we'll reach this day when sometime when we won't be able to do those things. My granddad told me, and I'm seeing more and more what he's talking about. I got a black avalanche. I gave another avalanche to my son. I wrecked it. It was paid for, so I used to do body work. So I fixed the truck and gave it to him, and he was putting some tires on it. And he's 30, and he was getting up. He's, I said, son, it gets worse. It gets worse as we go along. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. But if we can enjoy the things that God's got for us now, we need to do those things, because one of these days we're going to come to a slower pace and won't be able to do the things that we need to do. And my granddad said, son, there's things that I want to do. I know if I do it, I'll be in bed for 3 days. So you need to enjoy life now, living for Jesus and letting the Lord help you in these areas. But she's now in the presence of the Lord. There are pleasures forevermore. And the scripture tells us that we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and we'll give account of the stewardship of this life, so that we may receive the reward we have in this body, whether that's good or bad. And we have hope today that we'll see our sister again. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, receive Christ today. Jesus gave his life for our sins, and Sister Sybil took advantage of that, and she's been ushered into the presence of the Lord. So we want to encourage you, if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, some way, somehow, somewhere, talk to Jesus a little bit. He sends us into the earth with purpose, sends us into the earth with a plan, and God's got a plan for your life, and he wants to encourage you and help you along life's journey.
Sing to Jesus.
Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and still filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus.
Sister Sybil's life, that she's lived before her family and her friends and the church family. And Lord, we just pray right now that something that she said along life's journey, something she did along life's journey, as she lived her life for you, has taken a made impact and taken effect in someone's life that'll cause them to want to serve you and want to follow you and want to live for you and set that pattern for their family and for their friends and their loved ones. So, Lord, we just pray your blessings over each one. We pray that you'd minister grace in the days ahead and the weeks ahead, that you'd just touch this family. We know that there's going to be that emptiness there, that void there that Sister Sybil is leaving. And, Lord, we just pray that you'd give them the initiative and help them to have a desire to serve you and follow you, that they could go to this place where she is. So we just lift them up to you, and we speak peace and blessing into each one's life. Let it all be done for Jesus' sake. For his name's sake we pray. Amen. All but the immediate family would rise.
There's a light in the window. Table spreads. Someone standing by the open door. I can see the crystal bill. I must